Little red caboose, chuck, chuck, chuck. Little red caboose, chuck, chuck, chuck. Little red caboose behind a train. Wait, what's a caboose? Well, that's a silly question probably for most of you, because if you want to get technical outside of locomotives, the caboose is probably one of the most recognizable elements of railroading. Compared to pretty much every other car on a train, most people know what a caboose is. Maybe they don't know the details, but they can see it and recognize it, particularly the classic designed caboose, especially in North America, where they were mostly used. Over in the UK, for example, they do have a similar car known as a brake van, though they would call it that, not a caboose, but they have a pretty similar purpose. The idea of the caboose is to provide shelter for the crew at the end of a train, which, especially back in the day, were required for switching maneuvers as well as shunting, and to keep a lookout for load shifting, damage to equipment and cargo, as well as overheating axles. Brake vans over in the UK, as well as the Commonwealth Railways, were responsible for, well, pretty much all of that, as well as for trains that weren't fitted with continuous brakes to help provide a supplementary braking system. And since their trains used chain couplings, they would also help keep those couplings taut. But we don't see cabooses very often, if ever anymore. And it was once an incredibly common sight on any American railroad. Basically, if it was a freight train, you could almost guarantee there would be a caboose at the end of it. And yet, no longer. Why not? Why would you get rid of the adorable little red caboose? You monsters. Well, we'll get to that. But first, let's discuss the history of one of the most iconic elements of American railroading. The earliest uses of something like a caboose dates back to the 1830s, so they're almost as old as trains in general. Though back then, the cabooses were little more than flat cars or box cars that had been slightly remodeled to house trainmen. But the intention was the same. It was meant to be a shelter at the rear of the train, and in the early days of railroading especially, this was essential, not only for safety reasons, but to assist with switching maneuvers, as well as protecting the rear of the train when it was stopped. They also often inspected the train for a lot of problems, like shifting loads, broken equipment, or what are known as hot boxes. These refer to overheated axle bearings, and they can be incredibly dangerous, causing fires and resulting in derailments. The conductor of a freight train, at the bare minimum, would be housed in the caboose, and he would do his regular conductor job from there. Passenger trains generally wouldn't have had cabooses, since the conductor of those had to, well, be in the passenger train. And those cars are designed to house people already, but freight cars aren't. So the caboose was necessary, since, well, you couldn't exactly stick the conductor in a boxcar. I mean, I guess you could, but I don't think they would appreciate that very much. Over time, cabooses got a lot more livable. Like I said, at first they were little more than shacks on flat cars, but they would start making specially built cabooses, for the sole purpose of being cabooses. They would provide minimal living quarters, sleeping, sitting, and cooking areas, used for longer trips, and conductors that were on them regularly sometimes personalized and decorated them. The railroads generally didn't care about that as long as the crews were doing their jobs. The standard form of the American caboose had a platform at either end, with curved grab rails to facilitate train crew members' ascents onto a moving train. They would also be fitted with red lights that were called markers, so the rear of a train could be seen at night, and this was a very critical safety element, especially back in the old days before things like positive train control. Trains rear-ending each other wasn't unheard of, thus the lights allowed the engineers of a distant train to see the fact that they were about to plow into another one, and give them time to stop. The use of markers led to the phrase, bringing up the markers, which described the last car on a train. And it was so common, in fact, that those lights were officially what made a train, as far as railroads were concerned. They were that important. Early on, they would use oil lamps, though more modern cabooses would allow for electrical generators that were driven by belts coupled to one of their own axles, which charged batteries when the train was in motion. As I said, a lot of cabooses would have stoves, generally using coal or wood, though later they would start using kerosene heaters instead. The old stoves, which are actually pretty rare in the modern day in terms of preservation, are very specific, as they were designed for use on trains. They didn't have legs, for example. They were bolted directly into the floor. and they had a lip on the top surface to keep things like pans and coffee pots from sliding off while the train was in motion. Their doors also had double latches, not single, and that was to help prevent the discharge of hot coals while the caboose was again moving. And since cabooses were non-revenue equipment, they were actually improvised or retained well beyond the normal lifetime of regular freight cars. The concept of the little red caboose is because most lines actually painted them bright red, since it would make them easier to see. But other railroads got a little fancier with it and started painting them the same colors as their locomotives. Kansas City Southern Railway actually didn't paint their cabooses at all, as theirs had stainless steel car bodies, so they didn't feel they had to. But because they were on literally every single freight train on the lines, well, they became pretty recognizable, even to non-rail fans. If you were watching a freight train go by, you would expect to see a caboose at the tail end of it. And not every caboose is the classic caboose. I mean, in a children's drawing of a train, there's usually a steam engine, and maybe a boxcar, as those are also easily recognizable, and then there's a little red caboose. That's pretty common. I mean, I drew trains when I was young too, and I distinctly recall always drawing a caboose. But the classic caboose with the little windows on the roof is not the only kind of caboose, but it is what is known as the standard caboose, or the cupola caboose. The cupola name comes from the little thing up there. That's a cupola. And it had a very specific purpose. The crew would actually sit in elevated seats to inspect the train from those windows. It allowed them to see much further up than, well, if they weren't there. And while the stereotypical caboose has it centered, to be honest, the cupola was wherever. It depended on the railway, as well as whoever was building the caboose. It would be literally anywhere as long as it was on the roof. On Eastern railroads, they generally liked it in the center, but Western railroads liked it towards the end of the car. But some conductors actually liked it toward the front instead. So on the Western lines, the cabooses would just be flipped around. But some also liked it towards the rear of the train. And some just did not have time to care about this. But some cared, quite a lot. To the point that there was even a union agreement clause on the Santa Fe Railway that conductors were allowed to refuse to work until their caboose was facing the direction that they preferred. The issue didn't crop up that regularly, but personally I just want to be a fly on the wall during that board meeting. Like, it's one of the most minor requests of a union I've ever heard. Yes, and our next demand is that we want our cabooses to be facing the way we want. Really? That's all you want? Yes! You don't want anything else? You just want to be able to decide which direction the cabooses are facing. Yes! Oh. I mean, I think that's a little obsessive-compulsive of you, but, hey, mental health in this country definitely needs to make a lot of progress, so fine, you can have that. Speaking of that, we would like better health insurance- NEVER! But despite the cupolas being the most common, they weren't the only kind of caboose. There were also bay window cabooses. These are the ones with, well, without the cupola. And I bet you're wondering, well then how did the crew see forward? It's simple, they looked out the sides. See, the crew that was monitoring the train would sit in the middle of these cabooses, in a section of wall that projects from the sides. They resembled architectural bay windows, hence the name. And while it didn't do a very good job of letting them see the top of the train, it did allow them to see the sides a lot better. And quite a number of railroads actually preferred this. Baltimore and Ohio was actually well known for their admiration of this kind of caboose. They built all of their cabooses to this design, starting from an experimental model they tested in 1930. Other railroads liked it because it also eliminated the need for additional clearances, since the cupola added height. The bay windows didn't have to worry about that, and as such, they didn't have to build their tunnels or overpasses quite as high. This is also the caboose that is most similar to the United Kingdom's brake vans, as they were built pretty much in the same kind of way. Though in their case, the bay window was referred to as a lookout or ducket, but in any event, it did the same job. Then there were extended vision cabooses. These might look like cupolas, but honestly, they're kind of a merger of the last two. In this case, the cupola is, as you can see, widened, which allows the crews to see to the sides as well, just like the bay windows. These started becoming a lot more common after World War II, as some of the freight cars were becoming a lot taller, suddenly making it so that the regular cupolas couldn't actually see to the front of the train. and many old cupola cabooses would be modified in this manner. There are also transfer cabooses, which frankly just look like flat cars with shacks on them. Probably because that's basically what they are. They actually have the most in common with the original design of the old cabooses back in the 1830s. And even back in the heyday of the caboose, they weren't used very often because they weren't meant to be. These were meant for, as the name implies, transfer service between rail yards or very short switching runs. As a result, they didn't need to have things like sleeping, cooking, or restroom facilities like full-tilt cabooses did. And they left the ends open with safety railings, as for their purposes, these trains would often have to go in reverse, and as such, the crew would have to step outside and keep an eye on the rear to see where the train was going and make sure they didn't run into anything. And last, but certainly not least, there are drovers. Drovers look more like combined cars, and these were honestly the most specialized cabooses out of all of them because they had a very specific purpose. These were meant for livestock trains out in the American West. And the reason they look like combine pasture cars is that they basically were. Because the thing about livestock trains is that the livestock's handlers also had to come with the train, and they needed to sit somewhere. In these, the train crew would ride in the caboose section of the car, while the handlers rode in the coach area. So, with all this information, why don't we see cabooses that often anymore? They sound super useful and helpful on the railroad. And yeah, they were, for over 100 years. But in more recent times, their use has been questioned by modern railways, who have found other means to accomplish what a caboose does, but without needing them at all. They actually wanted to get rid of them sooner, but until the 1980s, there were laws in place in both the United States and Canada that required all freight trains to always have a caboose and full crews for safety reasons. But railroads had available technologies that they didn't have before and felt that they didn't need to have these full crews or cabooses at all. There are multiple listed reasons, but I'll give you the cliff notes. To begin with, modern diesel locomotives, especially comfort cab models, well, had larger cabs, and these could house entire crews if need be. Conductors generally no longer had to deal with manually flipped switches because those were controlled by dispatchers that were often miles away. There were also improved signaling systems, and that meant that they didn't need to be there to protect the rear of a stop train either. Modern bearings and line-side detectors were used to detect hotboxes in the modern day, so they didn't need to be there for that. And hotboxes weren't as common either, as modern freight cars would have proper roller bearings that didn't really have that issue. They also felt that the caboose was actually a dangerous place to be on a train, as slack in the train could hurl the crew forward or even dislodge heavy equipment in the caboose. Railroads proposed an alternative, known as an end-of-train device, sometimes called an EOT or ETD, or in railroad slang, the FRED, or flashing rear end device. This device could be attached to the rear of all their freight trains, and they had several jobs. They automatically detected the train's air brake pressure and reported any problems directly to the locomotive using telemetry. They also detected the movement of the train upon startup and radioed that information to the engineers so they knew that all of the slack was out of the couplings, and therefore additional power could be applied. And as their slang name implies, the Freds had blinking red lights, which did the job of the caboose in that way, warning other trains that there was a train on the line ahead. And with the introduction of the end-of-train device, the train's conductors could move up and be with the engineer in the locomotive. In 1982, a presidential emergency board convened under the Railway Labor Act and directed United States railroads to begin eliminating caboose cars where it was possible to do so. The only exception to this at the time was the state of Virginia. They had a state law in place that had been there since 1911 that also mandated the use of cabooses at the ends of trains. They wouldn't get rid of that law until 1988. Outside of that, though, railroads were finally allowed to begin removing cabooses from their regular trains. And that's why we don't see them very often anymore, but believe it or not, they're actually still in use. It's true, they're not nearly as common of a sight as they once were, but they do still exist, not just on heritage lines either. Some Class 1s still have their cabooses and utilize them for a variety of different needs. For example, local train runs actually find them very convenient, as they need a brakeman at the end of the train to operate the manual switches that still exist in those areas. And on longer reverse movements, they also are very necessary, because someone needs to stand at the rear of a train to see where they're reversing to. And they're often used on trains that are carrying very hazardous materials just for that extra safety. CSX, for example, still maintains a fleet of modified cabooses for regular uses. They utilize them as shoving platforms at the rear of local freight trains, as on their lines they often have to perform very long reverse moves or heavy switching, and as such the crews need a place to stand. And while these are rebuilt bay window cabooses, the crews no longer have access to all features, as the railway felt the need to permanently weld the cabin doors shut. Which sounds extreme? Like, wow!
Sitting down doesn't allow for productivity, don't you dare!
Like, that's a little crazy, you're not gonna lie. But, in any event, the crew still use them to just stand at the end of the train. BNSF actually also has a fleet of former wide vision cabooses, and use them for similar purposes. In 2013, they actually started repainting theirs in some of the heritage paint schemes of the railroads that preceded them, which is pretty cool, actually. And outside of their still continued use in some aspects in the actual industry, heritage lines always seem to have at least one caboose just hanging around, as, again, they are one of the most recognizable elements of the railroad. A lot of railroad museums actually roster quite a few cabooses. The Illinois Railway Museum, for example, has 19 of these things, and the Western Pacific Railroad Museum has 17. A lot of short lines still use them as well, as many of their routes still have manual switches, so someone still needs to be in the back. And even outside of proper preservation, or even being still utilized in some capacity, some cabooses have been repurposed entirely as vacation cottages, garden offices and private residences, portions of restaurants, and there was even some caboose motels, which literally lets you stay in cabooses, like they're the actual rooms that you pay for. Pretty cool, not gonna lie. And as I said when I started this video, outside of perhaps the actual locomotives, the caboose is easily one of the most instantly recognizable elements of railroading. There's a time they'd be on nearly every single freight train you could possibly imagine. And while it's sad that they aren't nearly as common, they're still around, and likely will continue to be, because let's be fair, every rail fan loves a little red caboose. And with that, a special thank you to all my underwater train finders, SomeDude267, Orange Glass, Benjamin Owens, Anzac A1, Arthur Roy, Brian, Jack Carson's Railway Videos, LordOff444, A-Person723, RoyalHuts2060, Isopher1405, Charles Kwiatkowski, Matt Weaver, Tom Redlion, NSProductions8104, WheelJack8401, Rescues Greyhounds, The Baxter, Caleb Crosswhite, Ohio Trucker 1, Andrew Bowen, Josh Johnson, Hayden DeGrow, Caleb Rainwaters, Prez Drenton, Master of None, Mr. Sleepy, Travis Alitsky, Jared Brussel, Joshua Long, Hannah Bird, Amtrak 2024 Productions, Tommy Rossini, Ben McCullough, Panzer Kitson 131-232, Mark Holding, Dr. Racer 78, G Wiz, Mr. Terevel, Liam Wright, and of course, my dad. Till next time, this is Darkness, and I bid you all a fond farewell.